Thank you, everyone, for listening to my presentation today. Recognised biosecurity groups are a model of community engagement in pest control in Western Australia. And today I'm going to talk about our experience as a group in becoming one and how that's impacted in our on-ground. So in Western Australia, across pest management, it's a three-pronged approach with government, industry and community working in this space. And community is made up of individual land managers, not-for-profits, and then the community groups that are typically derived from declared species groups that have been established in the early 1990s or through the NRM group model that we have across Australia. Using the invasion curve for pest management, our government agencies in the Department of Primary Industries and Regional Development and the Department of Biodiversities and Conservation Attraction really work in the area of prevention. We have industry funding schemes that work in the areas of eradication and containment, and then recognised biosecurity groups and landholders work in the area primarily of asset-based protection, although at times we move across to the left of the curve, working in the areas of containment and eradication, depending on what species we are targeting. Landholders that have growing concerns about declared weeds and feral animals in their communities can form a recognised biosecurity group under the Biosecurity and Agricultural Management Act 2007 in Western Australia. These groups are then funded by a declared pest rate, which is matched each year by the state government to double the funds available for use. RBGs are formally recognised by the Minister for Agriculture and have the ability to raise funds through a rate. They have financial stability, that is through the matched funding, and they provide a shared responsibility and funding and control for declared pests across the landscape. And it also then enables us to partner with others, including state government agencies, much more effectively because we have resources to contribute. In Western Australia in 2021, we have 14 recognised biosecurity groups that cover the majority of the state. You'll see on the map on the left there is an area of white in the Southwest Land Division where there is no biosecurity groups at present, and that is due to those communities not wanting one. The Minister will only form or recognise a biosecurity group at the community's request. And their role is to help landholders, both public and private, to control the declared pests, not to do it for the landholder, but to help. They build awareness, deliver training, information, hire out equipment, provide on-ground resources and other materials as needed for on-ground pest management activities. To become a recognised biosecurity group, it's usually driven from an existing community group within the community. As I said, whether that's an NRM group or a declared species group, which we've historically had in West Australia, or it can be formed by a new group. There is then a process to become recognised, which is driven through community consultation, becoming an incorporated association, having your own financial management and governance structures, undertaking the state government's process for recognition, having strategic and operational plans. From there, the main reason we do it is the ability to raise funds. Any landholder or board member of an RBG that I speak to is the key driver to become a recognised biosecurity group, and it's around local people making local decisions about local pests. Across the 14 RBGs in Western Australia, there's a range of plants and animals that are targeted. In the plant space, it comes from cottonbush, Pattinson's curse, blackberry, cape tulip, varietal creeper, cleavers, apple sodom, and some declared cacti species. And the vertebrate animals go from the red fox, rabbit, feral pig, wild dog, rainbow lorikeet, Mediterranean fruit fly, donkeys, and camels. There are currently the 14 RBGs, and in 2019-20, $5.374 million was raised and made available to these groups from the state government. This was through the applying of a flat or an ad valorem or a cents in the dollar rate on landholders within the regions, and we've had a 94% payment rate of that declared pest rate. The Minister each year determines the rate that's prescribed for an area in an RBG. The date EPR boundaries are recommended by the RBG in with landholder consultation. It is then matched dollar for dollar. The rate is collected by the state government in Western Australia and deposited into the declared pest account. And then these funds are then made available to the recognised biosecurity groups under their approved operational plans. So why a declared pest rate rather than a tender or a grant? The funding mechanism that RBGs can access of the declared pest account provides ongoing annual funding. This allows for certainty and long-term plans to be implemented with confidence, and the RBGs are responsible for how those funds are dispersed. There is no trying to meet funding guidelines. There is no competition between groups to hope that you get funded, and that really provides the certainty to underpin ongoing control programs across the landscape. I think I missed a slide there. Apologies. A key role in why RBGs are so successful is that you have to do continuous and frequent community engagement. It is absolutely critical to do this to get landholder support to ensure then that the minister approves the funds that you're asking for to implement the programs, and that you also have landholders on board to participate in the coordinated activities, from training to baiting days to shoots to any other control activities. RBGs also play a role in advocacy and representation. Landholders not receiving a direct benefit from the RBGs still can have wide rewards by participating in projects, advocacy and representation to prevent feral animals coming into their own landscapes. So our specific Central Wheatbelt Biosecurity Association is located in the northern agricultural zone of Western Australia. It covers just over 2 million hectares, and we have 65% of that land is rural wheat and sheep-based properties. We have 10% pastoral properties, 24% of the land within our area is government-managed lands, and less than 1% is town sites. Our role as an organisation is to provide leadership. It is not to be doing pest control for landholders. It's around collaborating with them to provide them with the skills, resources that's needed to implement landscape-wide nil tenure approach programs. This is overseen by 9 landholders on our board of management of directors, and it's about doing on-ground works. Each year we set an operational plan that's been consulted with the community on how to deliver the declared pest rate within our communities, and we report on that annually through our reports, which are submitted back to the community and back to the minister. Having a declared pest rate allows us to have a team on board, which starts with our board of management, which is all voluntary. We then have an executive officer and myself to oversee the governance and the administration tasks of the organisation. Our group specifically works majorly in the wild dog space. We have a dogger coordinator, and then we engage and contract the services of licensed pest management technicians. Our key program is the wild dog control program. We are focused around getting LPMT days on the ground to assist landholders with control techniques, specifically in trapping and baiting. We have a minimum number of traps in the ground, and we provide additional ground baiting to landholders. We undertake monitoring and surveillance, and we particularly are focused on working on government lands where we have an MOU around control and access of managing vertebrate pests on these lands. But the key is that we're the assistance to landholders. We're not doing it for them. As an adjunct to this, we are very big in our community bait rack program. We have 5 bait racks across the region because we'd identified in some of the barriers around why pest control wasn't being implemented regularly was access to baits. So we now run 5 bait racks that landholders who have permits can access all year round. And we have 2 bait making days per year where we make up to 40 to 50,000 dried meat baits, and they get put out as fresh dried meat baits as well as stored in the freezers for all year round targeted baiting programs in the wild dog control space. Each year we annually also coordinate an aerial baiting program using a helicopter across our own RBG, but also with our neighbouring RBGs. And looking at the map here, you can see to the north, top right-hand quarter of the map is the pastoral zone where we go onto, and the bottom is the Southwest Land Division's agricultural zone. And it's really important for us along the State Barrier Fence to maintain effective control for wild dogs coming into the agricultural lands, and doing an aerial baiting program is proving successful in this space. We monitor our impact and success of their programs through stocks loss reported. It's not actually through the number of dogs we trap or abated. So we have a great relationship with our landholders on the ground. And as you can see by the data we've been collecting since 2015 on stock loss reported, it was increasing to some extent in the lead up to 2017, where it peaked. And that was when we commenced our 3 years of coordinated control we've been doing so far. And up until the end of last year, we've been on a significant decline on stock impacts and stock deaths through wild dog control. So we have been communicating that to our communities, and very happy and pleased with the results to date. And it's just another way of showing it. So back in 2018, we were just under 500 stock loss reported for the year. We had around 30 dogs trapped, 15 were shot, and we had 63 wild dog sightings. Coming around to 2020, we only had 47 stock losses reported. We had 28 wild dogs trapped, 5 were shot, and only 6 other dog sightings that year from our programs across the region. We also work in the area of community rabbit control and annually provide and coordinate training and baiting programs with the community to manage rabbits. We're also working in the area of feral pig control, which is an emerging issue within our region, particularly in the western area of our region, with feral pigs being seeded into the landscape. And as you can see from the aerial images, we're collecting data at the moment about what impact that's having, particularly to crop and biodiversity assets within the region, and the damage being caused by wild pigs, and are beginning the coordinating landscape scale programs with landholders in this space. Our key role is also in monitoring and community reporting. So we use the national database in Wild Dog Scan and Wild Rabbit Span. We are very active within our community around reporting wild dog sign and any other vertebrate or declared species sign we encourage to be reported to us. But the key to all of this, apart from technology and programs, is our dogger coordinator. And I think it refers back to some earlier presentations today around trust and having the right people in those spots. So Russell is our dogger coordinator. He's a long-term, well-respected member of the communities that we work across. And having him on the end of the phone and landholders being able to report and engage to him cannot be replaced via a text message or an email or all that type of reporting service, is what we've observed to date. Our declared pest rate for 2021, to give you an idea on how much we rate the community, our group is asked the Minister for $160,000 to be rated in the communities that we represent. And that was for, we do an ad valerium rate, not a flat rate, so it's 0.0396 cents in the dollar on the unimproved value of land in the local government districts we operate in. It's for freehold land, and it's on properties no less than 100 hectares in area. So for us, we're focusing on the large agricultural properties. And we have a minimum rate amount of $80 per landholder. On average in our region, the landholders pay between $80 and $150 per bin towards a declared pest rate annually. But our largest or highest paying rate notice goes out at just over $1,000, to give you an understanding of what they're paying. We really look at this. This is a image of how our recent funding model for our groups works. So the top two lines.
Sorry, Linda, 1 minute.
Thank you.
1 minute pest left.
Rate. Yep. So we have our base funding with our declared pest rate, but it doesn't stop us, and we still look for grant funding, and we operate programs within the grant funding model as well, and look at declared pest rate for our base funding. So for us, the message is that the biosecurity is about prevention as much as it is control, and RBG is about local people making local decisions about local pests. So thank you very much for your time today.